Sir, please share your presentation. Share your screen, sir. Hello? 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 Sir, share your screen, sir. Share
yes,
your
sir.
presentation.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Share your presentation, sir.
Is it there, Meera, sir?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Fine, sir.
And how's the audio?
Audio is okay, sir.
Okay, thank you. Okay, Neeraj sir, you begin the countdown and whenever you say, I will start.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. A very good morning to all the, our dear students and all the life members who have joined us for this ninth session of rapid review course for postgraduate students. And at outset, I would like to thank you all for your overwhelming response for this initiative by Indian Society of Paedontology. And today we have none other than our own Secretary of Indian Society of Paedontology, Professor Dr. Harpreet Singh Grover sir. And sir needs no introduction. He is well known among the as an academician and as a practitioner and now as an administrator for Indian Society of Paedontology to everyone. Over to you, sir, for your scientific deliberation on controversies in paedontology.
Thank you, Dr. Neeraj. First of all, good morning to all the audiences who have joined. Very good morning to all of you. Neeraj sir, am I audible? Hello.
Yes, sir, you're audible. Continue, sir, you're audible.
Thank you. Neeraj sir, I would like to acknowledge your help right in the beginning. Because of you, this program has started. Of course, all the office bearers and EC members have helped envisage this particular program, but without your technical know-how, it would not have been possible. So my first acknowledgement goes to you right in the beginning.
Yes. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Today's topic is a very common topic, which is often repeated as a question. Paper 4 of NDS so many times, controversies in paedontology. Now, starting with that, this is my own quotation, you know, some time pass during the lockdown days. Once upon a time, we were taught to stay away from controversies. Now it is a part of our curriculum. So, times have changed and controversies have become a part of our curriculum. To start with, what is the meaning of the controversy? Controversy, as the dictionary describes it, is a public discussion and argument, sometimes heated, about something that many people strongly disagree about. There are many synonyms of controversy. Why I am telling you all the synonyms is sometimes...
Yeah. Excuse me, sir. Sir, there is still some disturbance in your audio. You could just try without earphones, sir. Directly on this computer. Okay. And sir, if you have any mobile or anything kept near laptop, just maybe disturbance because of the that also you keep it picked away.
If possible. Just check, sir. I've removed the mic, sir. Now, is it better?
Sir, better than earlier, sir. Continue,
better
sir.
Than earlier?
Yes, sir. Continue,
okay.
Sir.
Okay. Why I'm telling you all the synonyms of the controversy are that sometimes you not get a very straightforward question stating simply as write an essay on the controversies in periodontology. A change in the word, but the meaning is same. So you may get a question on write disagreements in periodontology, write disputes, dissensions, or debates in periodontology, or it may even come as what are the contentious issues in periodontology, and it may also come as what are the unexplained and unattributable questions arising in periodontology. So in the nutshell, it all means the same, whether it comes as disagreement, whether it comes as dispute or dissension. It essentially means that you have to write about the controversies in periodontology. What are the reasons for controversy? There are many reasons. First and foremost is improper or inadequate knowledge of the subject matter. Every author may feel his point of view of seeing a subject matter is better than the others, and so the controversy arises. For example, there is a raging controversy on the classification of periodontal diseases. It has been going on since ages. You know, some authors would want it this classification be based on etiology. Some would want it to base on clinical signs and symptoms. Some would want to base it on pathological signs. Some would like to base this classification on age or prevalence and whatnot. So one or the other point is always debated upon, and the controversy remains. Sometimes the controversies are driven by commercial or company-driven interests. In today's commercial world, it is imperative that companies would try to outshine the other companies by stating that their products are always better, and what better than to create a controversy about the other product. But there's a third reason also, and so many times this reason also becomes the reason for a controversy. And this particular reason is controversy sells. If there's a controversy, then it will generate interest, and in the TV parlance, this would mean increase TRP ratings or increase audiences for that particular, you know, controversy. So controversies, basically it becomes a selling point. The famous British essayist William Hazlitt famously quoted some 200 years ago, and this quotation still stands: when a thing ceases to be a subject of controversy, it ceases to be a subject of interest. Very true, very, very true, especially as we go on with the coming slides, we will see that how it is true. I would say the first two major controversies of modern periodontics can arguably be the tissue barrier concept and the ultrastructure of the dentogingival junction. Both these controversies erupted in late 70s, and as they say, the jury is still out, because even now we find papers in the journals stating one or the other point of view. Tissue barrier concept, you all are aware, was outlined by Goldman and Cohen 1979, and it postulated that you always require a dense collagenous band of connective tissue, which basically acts as a barrier and retards the spread of inflammation into the loose alveolar mucosa. Agreed. And therefore, they recommended that there should always be an adequate zone of gingiva to limit the spread of the inflammation. Again, agreed. But this concept was totally different to what was being practiced hitherto. So what the authors meant, basically Goldman and Cohen meant, that if the adequate band of attached gingiva is not available, you better create it. So this concept was endorsed upon by another very famous study done by Kennedy et al. In 1985, and this was published in the Journal of Clinical Periodontology. This was 1985 study, and they also basically endorsed the view of Goldman done. This study was a 6-year follow-up study, and there the researchers, you know, areas of attached gingiva and areas where there was inadequate attached gingiva, and finally opined that a good adequate band of attached gingiva is a must if you want to arrest the disease. This concept of Goldman and Cohen was totally opposite to what Weyerhaeuser, Jens Weyerhaeuser, had observed in 1971. His acute observation was that teeth possessing the least attached tissue, that is, we all know cuspids and bicuspids, are always the least involved periodontally, whereas the incidence of disease is the greatest on the lingual and palatal surfaces, where the amount of keratinized tissue is greatest. So, what he basically meant was that it is actually the plaque control which is the key, and not the adequateness of the attached gingiva. His point of view was that if we maintain excellent plaque control, which was very, very prevalent, because Jens Weyerhaeuser comes from Scandinavia, which had the highest levels of plaque control maintenance at that time also. So his point of view was that if we are maintaining a scrupulous plaque control, then there is absolutely no need for having an adequate attached gingiva, and it is not good to subject the patients to some other surgeries whereby we are increasing simply the band of attached gingiva, because we think that that would arrest the further disease. So his, you know, concern was basically scrupulous plaque control. So he said if there is zero attached gingiva, even if there is zero attached gingiva, the patient can still remain disease free if he is maintaining an excellent plaque control. His view also was supported by many, and one of the landmark studies, again reported in Journal of Clinical Periodontology, was by Wenstrom and Linde in 1983. So their study also concluded that they could not find much, you know, difference between the two areas, one area having adequate width of attached gingiva, the other area having a limited attached gingiva. And if they basically concurred with the Jens Weyerhaeuser 1971 concepts of an excellent plaque control, because they stated that when excellent plaque control was maintained, they could obtain equally good results on both the sides. This study was done on beagle dogs, of course, and this study also carries a lot of merit in the literature. So again, we see there were two schools of thoughts, and that question has till date not been very satisfactorily answered, because the world has moved on to newer controversies. So this controversy probably was laid to rest, and it was left to the individual viewpoint as to one wants to hold what. So the next, and again a very big controversy, erupted over the ultrastructure of the dento-gingival junction. We all know how important the junctional epithelium is, because the dento-gingival junction and the junctional epithelium together constitute a barrier which prohibits bacterial ingress. Every periodontist, every dentist knows this basic philosophy, that the dento-gingival junction is a unique junction which disallows the ingress of the microorganisms. Now, what exactly holds this dento-gingival junction? What exactly holds the junctional epithelium to the tooth? This concept, basically the ultrastructure of the dento-gingival junction, started in 1921. It started with the Gottlieb's concept, where Gottlieb came with the epithelial cuff. He he explained the structure, but in 1921 he called it a epithelial cuff. 10 years later, Cronfield did some studies on the optical microscope, because at that time only optical microscope was present, and he said this, which has been described by Gottlieb in 1921, this epithelial cuff is attached to the tooth, whether at cementum or whether at enamel, but it is attached to the tooth, period. Then 1953, Baum did phase contrast microscope studies, because as the microscopes were improving, things were becoming clearer. So Baum in 1953, after doing phase contrast microscope studies, said that yes, there is a junction, and this junction is held by tonofilaments. So he could see the presence of tonofilaments there. In 1966, the term junctional epithelium was coined, and the same year, in the first electron microscope study, Max Listgarten, he came up with the ultrastructure of the dentogingival junction. He said there is presence of desmosomes at this junction. There is the basement lamina, axial lamina also, on whom these hemidesmosomes are resting. So Listgarten said that the junction, that this junction is held by desmosomes along with the basal lamina or basement lamina, whatever you may call it. That was in 66. Again, a decade passed, and then finally these Japanese authors, Kobayashi, Rose and Mahan, they reported in Journal of Periodontal Research. This, their research was done on 5 rhesus monkeys, and they came up with the complete ultrastructure of the dentogingival junction. Now, what did they say? They say what Listgarten has said is true, but along with hemidesmosomes, there are other elements which adheres this junction to the enamel or the cementum. Now, this glue which binds this hemidesmosomes to the tooth remained an enigma. The conformation of this structure, the complete structure of dentogingival junction, was confirmed, whatever said in
1980. Hello, sorry to disturb you, sir.
Please, sir.
Sir, there is again some disturbance in your voice quality. If you have some other mic, can we just try that other than this?
Okay, sir. Hello.
Yes, sir. Connected, sir. You're connected, sir. You're connected with the computer, sir?
Yes, sir.
Still, there is some disturbance, actually.
Check again, sir.
Yes, sir. Maybe possible it's because of network, not because of mic. I don't know.
Yes, sir. Am I audible, sir? Now. Hello.
Ha, sir. But then earlier was better. Then without mic was better.
Okay.
We'll continue like that only, sir.
Okay. Sir.
Maybe some network issue or.
Hello. Yes. Sir, can I continue?
Yes, sir. Continue, sir.
Thank you. So after this concept of 1976, where the ultrastructure was described by Kobayashi, Rose and Mahan on rhesus monkeys, this was confirmed on human samples by document JD, and he said that same unit of attachment which was existing in the rhesus monkeys exists in the human being also. And he also said that he has found the complete unit of dentogingival junction, which is now, he said, which is now hemidesmosomes, a basal lamina, and a layer which he called as sublamina lucida. So what he meant was that, sorry, it's a poor quality picture, but I could get this picture only to describe this particular junction. You can see inset A and inset B. Inset A is basically the attachment apparatus, and inset B has been magnified, this attachment apparatus. So in this inset B, what we finally see is hemidesmosomes, and hemidesmosomes resting over a basal lamina, and this basal lamina basically constitutes of a lamina lucida and a lamina densa. So in 1976 and 1986, the layer which came into picture was a 95 angstrom layer sublamina lucida, which was adjacent to the enamel. So sublamina lucida adjacent to the enamel was in between the lamina densa of the basal lamina and the enamel. So what was the physicochemical nature of this sublamina lucida? It is very important to understand this particular nature, because as periodontists, this junction remains very, very unique, and we must understand the complete physicochemical nature. So controversy erupted over what this SLL or sublamina lucida has. First one, of course, was by the original authors Kobayashi, Rose and Mahan, who first found this existence of sublamina lucida, and they said that this is the zone of London van der Waals electrostatic forces, and these forces in conjugation with hemidesmosomes bind the junctional epithelium to the dentogingival junction. Then came another viewpoint. This was in 1978, and Journal of Dental Research, Buchanan and Bernard, they said this sublamina lucida is extracellular epithelial attachment substance, the nature of which they could not very much delve upon. But they said that this is not London van der Waals forces, this is a extracellular EAS. They called it EAS. Now what this EAS was, they remained silent on that. Then came another study in 1985 where they stated, McKinney et al., they stated that sublamina lucida basically contains fibronectin-like glycoproteins, and these glycoproteins are the actual junctional glue. So now we had London van der Waals forces, we had EAS, and now the third one was fibronectin-like glycoproteins. Doffman, 1986, called it a special mucus secretion. He said there's a special mucus secretion which binds this particular junction to the tooth, and it is just a secretion, this layer sublamina lucida. I also did one research on the biophysical studies of gingival epithelium. That was in 2011, and we were basically interested to see whether calcium ions play any role in the interplay of this binding of junctional epithelium to the tooth, and we basically measure the resting membrane potentials of the three types of cells, the junctional, crevicular, and surface epithelium, to see how the cell membrane varies and whether the cell membrane variation can cause some sensation at the junction so that the attachment occurs. So we basically were focusing on the cross-linking role of the calcium ions in the subliminal loci. Anyways, this this controversy is again has again been put to rest, because again you are free to write any origin of subliminal lucida as long as a student you recognize that there is presence of this layer. And it is important to know, because this is the latest and complete junction of the dentoepithelial attachment. So besides these two controversies, there was another very famous controversy, and this again was created by Jens Weerhaeck's critique on lack of philosophy of periodontal surgery. You see, during that era, since Whitman described the flap, and in 1931 the Kirkland flap came into vogue, and meanwhile there were various displaced flaps going on. The entire 5-6 decades, every now and then some modification on the original surgery made by Whitman was coming, or some other different modality of surgery were coming, and there was a lot of confusion in those 6-7 decades till modified Whitman flap came in 1904. But this critique was written before that. So it was basically to describe those 50 years, 1921 to 1971. And I will actually read out, because this is a part of portion of history, what I am reading out as to what Jens Weerhaeck wrote about the philosophy of periodontal surgery at that time. So I will just take 2 minutes reading it. Focus on the red mark, lack of a philosophy of periodontal surgery. The dilemma of periodontology in 1970 arises from lack of a generally accepted philosophy on which gingival surgery can be safely based. And there is no agreement regarding the goal. Over the years, innumerable surgical techniques have been described and advocated. Apparently, every self-respecting periodontist must develop his own method or modify another method. Often, such new methods are described at periodontal meetings or published in dental journals long before their advantages and disadvantages have been established and before their efficacy has been compared with other methods. Many clinicians seem obsessed by a desire to cut the gingiva without considering what beneficial effect the cutting may have for the patient. In addition, physicians and dentists, like women, are fashion-minded. If one leading periodontist has started to use a certain technique, everybody must use the same method. Thus, for the purpose of increasing the width of the attached gingiva, it may be the highest fashion 1 year to expose the alveolar bone or periosteum by throwing away the mucosa that covered it. Then next year, mucosa may be transplanted for the same purpose from a distant site as free gingival grafts. Some periodontists reposition the flaps apically, where others push them coronally. 1 year bony defects are eliminated by osteotomy. The next year they are eliminated by one type or another of bone graft. One may ask, what is going to happen next? Are we going back to the fashions from the beginning of this century, as has happened with clothing, haircuts, and beards? I am trying to point out that the development of surgical methods has been influenced by coincidence more than by organized clinical trials. and that these methods reflect exhibitionism rather than biological insight. At least one thing has evolved from this uninhibited experimentation on surgical methods. The patients have a highly developed capacity for survival, and the periodontal structures have a remarkable capacity for healing because successful results have been claimed for all the methods. A skeptic may be allowed to inquire, is it because of the treatment or in spite of it? Golden words, putting into perspective every surgical technique of the last 50 years, because many of them were simply individual efforts. For the next 15 years or 10 years, there was a lot, but we can say more controversies were brewing, and it was the proverbial calm before the storm. Come 2002 and Periodontology 2000, the whole volume has been devoted to the controversies in periodontology, because by this time new controversies had come in the professional fora. There are many controversies, so I have tried basically to pick up some, and I will try to explain them little by little, because most of the controversies you can were settled sometimes later, sometimes they have not been even settled. So what were those controversies which Periodontology 2000 came up with? The first is a well-known controversy, classifying periodontal diseases, a long-standing dilemma. Yes, there has been a dilemma, and there is still a dilemma, because even with the new classifications, which has recently come up, murmurs have already started that this is certainly not a classification which would withstand the test of time for a long, long time. So that even the new classification, it is already into controversy. Then there were controversies on non-inflammatory destructive periodontal disease. What are the beneficial bacteria of the periodontium? Then periodontitis, systemic disease associations. This was, of course, in the presence of smoking, whether it is causal or coincidental. Then invasiveness of the oral bacteria, periodontal epithelium, more controversies, what is its role in health and disease, trends in periodontal care, genetic risk factors. Of course, it's an area where always lots of controversies are there. The role of stress again in inflammatory disease, including periodontal disease. Some studies are still being done, but nothing has been settled, whether to the role of the stress or the role of cortisol, etc., which are associated with it. Then, at that time, since implants were just beginning to interest people, so the controversies were basically only on the treatment planning. Later on, of course, controversies on each and every aspect of the implant, we will soon come to that, also were there. But 2002 was a nascent year regarding implantology. So controversies were beginning about the treatment planning. And of course, another which came first, the chicken or the egg, the periodontal endodontic controversy, it rages on and on. So till 2002, we've seen the list, what controversial topics which period 2000 came up as a volume. So this you can note down, and this can be used as a resource material. I'll of course refer to other resource materials also. But we see between 2002 and now coming to 2015, everything was not very peaceful. There was a lot cooking or brewing, whatever you may call it, because more controversies were getting ready. So come 2015, and I'm sure many of you would be familiar with this particular term, Dental Clinics of North America. They, you know, came up with unanswered questions in periodontology, and unanswered is a euphemism for controversies only. So, more controversies. And what were that? What is the contribution of genetics to periodontic risk? Yes, by this time, we had known the genetic contribution to certain, you know, COX-2 genes, IL-10, IL-1 genes, this was known. But how much was the contribution of each to different, you know, different areas of defense in the periodontal inflammatory disease, and of course in aggressive periodontitis. So this was an area of controversy. What is the contribution, exact contribution, whether, and then some, you know, controversies on what is the proper sample size for the studies of periodontal treatment. I'll tell you one, you know, true incident when I was teaching, and I received a, you know, thesis for evaluation. And as we all know, thesis time, there's always panic, sir, kitna rakhna hai, kitna implant dalna hai, kitna chahiye, aapne 20 likha diya, 12 pe ho jaye. All that, you know, we are all part of that ecosystem jahan pe there's always a tug of war between what PGs want and what guides want. Anyways, this particular thesis had, you know, seven sample size of seven. Seven for and seven for against. And the moment I received that thesis, I called the HOD, said, sir, ye sample size kam hai isme, did you take a statistician's help? Arey sir, statistician kya bachcho ko sikhane ke liye saath bahut hai. No, you can't, you know, argue with this. I would say zero marks for statistics, but full marks for the honesty of the HOD. ठीक है बच्चों को सिखाने के लिए तो साथ बहुत है. Actually, you know, this there needs to be a basic, you know, proper sample size, because a low sample size would always mean a low statistical power to show the effect of that particular thing which you want to show. So this is important, that you need to have a proper sample size. Then controversies regarding mouthwash. मेरा माउथ वॉश इससे बेटर है बिकॉज आई हैव एसेंशियल ऑयल्स एंड यू हैव क्लोरहेक्सिडिन एंड आई हैव थायमोल मेंथॉल एंड व्हाट नॉट. यू नो, ऑलवेज अ टफ वॉर एज टू व्हाट इज बेटर. एंड दिस इज, यू नो, समटाइम्स व्हाट आई मेंट वाज कंपनी ड्रिवन और कमर्शियल इंटरेस्ट एज टू विच माउथ वॉश यू वॉन्ट टू. ऑफकोर्स वी नो क्लोरहेक्सिडिन 0.2%, एवरीबडी नोज, बट स्टिल टिल डेट, यू नो, every now and then you come up with a new mouthwash which wants to dislodge the supremacy of chlorhexidine gluconate. Then what is the role of photodynamic therapy? Another, you know, controversial area. Then radiologic assessment of alveolar crest height. Is it useful to monitor periodontal disease activity, do mobility and occlusal trauma impact periodontal longevity? Yes, again, there's a question mark as to how much important points, but it is controversial. Then, does treatment of periodontal disease influence systemic disease? Bartold, Mark Bartold, the editor of Australian Dental Association Journal, in 2010-11, he said there are 44 diseases which are now linked to this periosystemic interlink. Now, he actually gave a list also in that editorial, how much of those 44 diseases we can actually, you know, take up as some cause and effect relationship remains to be seen. But this is, periodontal medicine is a huge area of controversy till date. Should antibiotics be prescribed? Another, you know, very critical area where we are prescribing antibiotics right, left, and center, whereas in the literature we see there are very limited conditions during which we can give antibiotics. I'm sure you all know those 3-4 conditions which are there in the literature, but still we continue to give antibiotics as if there is no tomorrow. Unanswered question more, can bone loss from percussions be regenerated? Thousands of theses in, I think, RPGs have done, and they've used probably every mocktail and cocktail to regenerate bone loss from percussions, 1 millimeter, 1.5 millimeter, who knows. But again, you know, this is an area which is full of controversy as to whether you actually require also to regenerate 1 or 2 millimeter of bone by putting expensive, you know, mocktails, cocktails in it, even when a regular, you know, self-cleaning exercises can be done for the benefit of the patients. Can periimplantitis be treated? Question mark. I'll comment on it further. Does gingival recession require surgical treatment? Yes and no, we all know. So this, you know, the DCNA 1915 came from the US. But if US does something, how can the Aussies or the Australians be far behind? Right in the same year, in the same month, they came with their own version of more controversies. And this came in a tome called Current Issues in Periodontics. This also came in October 2015. And the Yankees also came with their version in 2015. And the biggest, you know, thing is that the two controversies on both the sides, Aussies and Yankees, they don't match. Aussies have come up with their own set of controversies. Let us see. Now, they have come with their set of controversies since regeneration, periodontal regeneration was the in thing during those days. You know, lots of Italians and all those people are doing a lot of periodontal regeneration. So, Aussies, you know, came up with their set of controversies in the field of, particularly in the field of periodontal regeneration, and it started with the first topic as translational research of periodontal regeneration using cell sheet engineering. Then emerging regenerative approaches for periodontal regeneration, again on stem cells. Then use of stem cells for periodontal regeneration. Human viruses, yes, it will become more acute now after COVID outbreak, I'm sure. Human viruses, again, interest will be, you know, generated as to see what damage they can actually do to the attachment apparatus. Effect of vitamin D, we know many theses have already been done, but again, as they say, the jury is still out. Etiology of drug-induced gingival overgrowth, then overview of risk of maternal periodontal disease, periosystemic links. Periodontal disease, is it a local immune response? Post-modulation, again, you know, controversy in everything. Current updates on orthodontic-periodontic interrelationship and current approaches to periodontal surgical flaps, more controversies. So this was the, you know, Aussie set of controversies in 2015, and preservation or reconstruction, what do you want? Then periodontal competency for the long-term success of implants, because 2015 implants were very much in the work. With the changing times, the script also changed and implants became the flavor of the season, and all rebel rousers, all controversy theorists now jumped on from periodontology to implantology, and how. So the pertinent questions raised were, is treatment of periodontal disease predictable? If it is not, implantology is the answer. Do dental implants present with better prognosis and fewer complications? Are patients more satisfied with tooth extraction and an implant? Can the extraction of a periodontally compromised tooth and its replacement with a dental implant be justified from an economic point of view? Are aesthetics after conventional periodontal therapy as acceptable as those after implant therapy. Now, what has happened was, since many, you know, implants were being put everywhere in the world, and see, this was a radiograph 12 years after treatment with a simple periodontal surgery. In equally long, you know, implant follow-up was also put up. So it was, you know, a shadow boxing between purists and implantologists. The purists were the fundamental periodontists who were trying to save the teeth any which way and keeping it in the mouth right up to 30 years, because there were many Scandinavian, you know, researchers who had 30 years of follow-ups. But by this time, implant follow-ups were also good and they were also coming. So the controversies now started to come. The first was that there are a lot of, you know, peri-implant mucositis and peri-implantitis associated with it. And in 2015, a systematic review based on European Consensus Conference revealed that the prevalence of peri-implant mucositis and peri-implantitis ranges from 19% to 65%. That is an alarming rate. So, and another, you know, statement which read that this month, which was January 2016, results from one of the largest studies performed in Sweden show that peri-implantitis and peri-implant mucositis are common biological complications of implant therapy that may jeopardize the longevity of reconstructions on implants. So the confusion was whether to retain the original tooth by doing, you know, conventional periodontal procedures or go for implants and then maybe later on suffer the consequences of having frequent peri-implantitis and mucositis. And this, you know, question became important because almost 1 million implants were placed, you know, are being placed every year, and almost 10% of all implants would probably need a periodontist look to take care of the associated peri-implantitis, etc. Thus, you know, this last 10 years have seen a literal boxing match. I, you know, to be politically correct, I call it a dialogue between the two schools. One, you know, which I call implantomania, the other I call herodontics, with a call to action to revisit the success of periodontally maintained teeth versus the successes achieved via implant therapy. So, you cannot win this, the argument match, and it is bound to go on for some time. And it became such a, you know, problematic situation that the great Carl E. Misch, who wrote Contemporary Implant Dentistry, just before his death was writing Avoiding Complications in Oral Implantology. So this was pretty soon, you know, after writing a book on the basics and then coming up with something, Avoiding Complications, because complications were creeping in whatever being said and done. More controversies were coming into implantology. Now it was the turn of Spanish authors. They, you know, came up with a book which was released by Quintessence, Controversial Issues in Implant Dentistry. According to them, you know, everything in implant, right from, you know, the length of the implant, do shorter implants have a short lifespan, or do the immediate implants come out immediately, whatever, you know, the controversial issues were there, ranging from the patient, the service characteristics, the platform switch, anything and everything, you know, whatever you say, right up to even the concept of osseointegration is no more safe. It is being taken up by the concept of osseoincorporation. So nothing remains sacrosanct in the war of controversies. 2017, again, you know, controversies in implant surgery. This very informative article came in Dental Clinics of Oral and Maxillofacial Surgery, Dental Clinics of North America only, you know, publishes it. And this had its own horror stories of, you know, implant-related complications. And another term which was released in 2017, again, edited by Mark Bartold, now, you know, took over the rest of the things which have not been controversial till now. Now, they picked up PRF, which we know, again, is a very, very, you know, concept, which is a much flogged horse as far as we in Perio are concerned. There have been so many, you know, articles written, but till date, how effective it is remains an enigma. So more controversies, implant placement in grafted nearby bites. Now, since CBCT was coming, how can they be far behind? Now, CBCT was taken into loop and split crest technique for alveolar narrow ridge, more controversies, saving compromised implants and clinical strategies for implant treatment in patients with periodontitis. More recently, whatever was left has, you know, become controversial. And this 2019 article in National Journal of Implant Dentistry, now they say that occlusal overload with dental implants, it needs a big review as to how much, you know, overloading or how much, in fact, loading and whether it was overloading has been carried out hitherto. So it's a good review, but now, you know, it is occlusion that has come into controversy. And, you know, finally, I would say, it has become a free-for-all. You know, it is Britishers, Burmese versus Yankees versus Aussies, each trying to press, you know, the other's voice, the muzzle the other's voice by creating their own set of, you know, rules, treatment procedures, whatever you may call it, but controversy has become the name of the game, especially in periodontology. And what has that resulted? That has resulted, it's a humor slide, it is more controversies mean more seminars and more sessions for the PGs, and what could be bad than that? It is simply a case of death by PowerPoint by generations of PGs, considering the amount of controversies we have. So, coming to the conclusion, this is a modern era Shakespeare. What's in a name? Well, in his times, he probably said nothing. A rose would smell as sweet, you know, if it is called by any other name. All that has been consigned to the dustbins of history. What's in a name? Modern day Shakespeare would say, well, everything. Why? You see, Dangal, Nam, see the names, Halla Bol, Khabardar, Kurukshetra, these are the TV debate shows which we see every day, more so in lockdown, you know. All these names basically are kept to create, you know, controversies, and the more the controversies, the more the TRPs, and that is why, you know, such names of these TV shows are there. What is my advice? My advice is, do not play a devil's advocate. There is no need to favor one view over the other. We have to keep a balanced approach. As periodontists, students of periodontology, we need to play safe. We need to have a balanced view. Your decision making, even at the time of writing your answers, should not be based on mere facts. Your decision making should always follow the pyramid of evidence. You see, most of these controversies, or many of these controversies, they do not follow the pyramid of evidence. Whereas, as true clinicians, as true professionals, as true proponents of our great branch, we always need to follow the pyramid of evidence, because cold gold standardized by meta-analysis or systematic reviews, we can always put that yes, whatever we oversee, this is the correct thing to answer. In the end, I would thank you for all your patient hearing. I know the sound quality at times may not have been so good, but thank you so much. And my acknowledgement is due to my society, the Great Indian Society of Periodontology, which has been formed in 1975 with the primary aim of promoting and enhancing the knowledge and science of periodontology in India. I hope the series, which has been envisaged by Madam President Dr. Nivya and rest of the office bearers and greatly coordinated by Dr. Neeraj, has been useful to you, and you are enjoying these webinars. If you continue to do so, we can have some more plan for you. With these words, I thank you. I thank all of you, and I am open to any questions. I think for the next 5 minutes, if Dr. Neeraj permits, or if I have the time.
Yes, sir. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir, for covering almost like all the controversies in periodontology. And as we were discussing, the controversy is another name for periodontology. And there are a few questions, sir. First and foremost is the students are always confused regarding the classification system, and more so now because of new classification system which has come. So can you just enlighten them about your views on what to do in the exam regarding the classification of periodontology? Which classification,
sir,
to use?
Sure, Neera sir, thank you so much. It's a wonderful question which you have raised. And I think as far as the classification part is concerned, I would still, my money would still remain in what has been given in 10th edition, 10th edition of Carranza, the classification. Because that classification has stood the time for almost, a good number of years. The new classification, yes, it is desirable to know that a new classification has come, that is desirable. But this classification has to pass the test of time. Till it passes the test of time, it cannot be said that this is the ultimate, this is the nirvana situation as far as we periodontists are concerned. So
yes,
I would still say, if I'm an examiner, I'm an excellent examiner, if a student is answering me, the classification given still in the 10th edition, I would be very happy.
Thank you. Sir, a few students have asked how to elaborate on the class controversy related to attached gingiva.
Yes. Sir, I would say that you may not find too much articles, but you can always consider the textbook of Goldman and Cohen for this. Goldman and Cohen has the best literature as far as this, because this concept itself was evolved by them only. So they have tried to put it in their textbook, and I would suggest if they can get hold of it. Is old, only old editions are there, but it is there in all the libraries. So you should consider that.
Sir, regarding the controversies related to the periodontal dressing or periodontal pack. Hello?
Yes,
sir.
Again, it's a very valid question you have raised, because many a time we have this question coming up of whether to do dressings or not. But again, like other controversies, there are again two schools of thought, whether to cover it with a periodontal pack or do not cover it. As far as we are, I am personally concerned, I would go with the school of thought where they put a periodontal pack. Because all certain dancer, why I am saying that, it is based on literature survey only. The main essence of healing is always preserve the clot. If we have preserved the clot, we will have impeccable healing. That is the fundamental thing. And anything which helps to preserve the clot to stabilize the clot is more
Hello.
than welcome, and that will give us a good healing. So if we put a
Hello.
Bell-Bronte pack, we at least ensure from our end that
Hello.
we have, sorry, sir, shall I repeat? Sir?
Hello.
Yeah. Shall I repeat, sir?
Hello.
Are you getting me, sir?
No, sir. There are some audio issues.
Hello. Are you getting me, sir? Hello. Sir, I think students can hear. They are writing. We can hear you. We can hear both of you. So, shall I speak?
Yes, sir. Continue.
Yes, sir. What I was saying is that our primary aim of healing is to stabilize the clot. And anything which helps us to stabilize the clot is more than welcome. So, in essence, a periodontal pack, which of course is a non-eugenol-based thing, which we are using, the current periodontal pack and all, they basically help us to stabilize the clot. And if we stabilize the clot, we are going to get a good healing. For this reason only, it should be put.
Okay. Sir, controversy related to even local drug delivery.
Yes, sir. Local drug delivery, actually, there's an article on host modulation and local drug delivery, which I put a slide, but
yes,
it was not possible to touch every aspect. So
yes, sir.
I've tried to give whatever the resource material is available so the students can consult that slide. It has a section on local drug delivery also.
Okay. Thank you very much, sir, for your wonderful and enlightening lecture and covering almost all the controversial topics on in periodontology. And thank you for sharing all the detailed resource material related to different controversies, wherein the students can explore those resource materials and just come to some conclusion regarding the controversies. Thank you very much, sir. And we'll sign off now, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you
all. The idea was to give them the resource material.
Yes,
thank you
yes,
so
sir.
Much.
Yes,
thank
sir.
You,
thank
madam,
you.
Also.
Thank you.